A common question for investment banking interviews that throws people for a loop is drawing the connections between unlevered free cash flow and the cash flow that's calculated in the cash flow statement, particularly CFO and CFI. And what I'm going to walk through here is the common threads that connect these calculations. Then we'll talk about the differences, and in the process, we'll answer another tricky interview question, which is whether or not CFO in particular is a levered or unlevered metric. So that's the game plan here. Let's dive in. Now, to jump right into this, I've laid out a simple scenario here in the middle with our basic income statement, and I'm going to walk through each of the different approaches, and we're going to start with the unlevered free cash flow approach. So over on the left-hand side here, we're going to work from the EBIT to our unlevered free cash flow. I'm going to start by pulling in the 100 of EBIT on the left-hand side. We're then going to adjust the taxes out as well. So we're moving down the P&L, incorporating our taxes here. We're then going to add back the D&A that's embedded in EBIT up above. So we'll add back the $20 of D&A. And then we're going to adjust for the change in working capital. So working capital is going up by $5, which means that we have a $5 use of cash. And then at the bottom of the screen here, if you look down at the bottom, we have this $10 of CapEx, which is $10 out the door as well. So in the end, we have essentially 100 minus 15 because the 220s cancel out here. So we have $85 of free cash flow. And what I want to stop here and note is that $85 really reflects the root cash flow that the business generates, the underlying cash flow generation capability of this business for this period. And what I want to just stop and note here is our flow. So we went from the top of this with EBIT down to our tax expense. Then we moved down and incorporated our D&A. We incorporated the working capital and we incorporated our CapEx. So we're kind of working from the top here. So at our EBIT level and working our way down. The big difference with the cash flow statement approach is that we actually start with net income, which already incorporates some of the elements that we would otherwise have included in the other approach. And now with the cash flow driven approach, what we're really going to do is start from the bottom of the P&L instead. So we're starting here. So we're going to have our 80 of net income. We're then going to add back 20 of D&A, and we're kind of following a similar approach to what we did on the left. It's just a slightly different ordering. So we have 5 out for our working capital. So that gets us to 95 of CFO, and then 10 out for CapEx. So CFO minus CFI is 85 here. And I want to note a few things again before we jump ahead. So the first thing is we ended up in the same place on both sides here. So we have 85 and 85. As we'll see, that changes when you incorporate interest expense. But we ended up in the same place is the first thing to note. And the other thing to note is that we're really kind of doing the same thing on the left-hand side and the right-hand side here. The difference is really starting at EBIT and working our way down as opposed to starting at net income, which already incorporates certain components. So said slightly differently, if we look at the EBIT and the taxes, that's already embedded in our net income. Our next two items are D&A and working capital. And then our CapEx is incorporated via CFI. So it's just two different ways of doing the same thing is the first thing to capture here. Now, beyond that, the other thing to capture here is that with our cash flow driven approach, we're starting with net income. And if we move everything over here for a second, so I'm going to create a little space for us just to allow us to add some more data. So if we add a second scenario where we incorporate interest expense, so I'm going to add in $10 of interest expense. What we're going to end up with here is now 90 of earnings before taxes. And at a 20% tax rate, which is what I'm implicitly assuming here, that means we have 18 of 20 of taxes. And as a result of this, I now have 72 of net income as my starting point. The thing I want you to capture here is that there's an $8 difference between these two approaches. And what you're seeing there is the impact of the interest tax shield. So we take out the $10 of interest, but we get a slight shield for this and our taxes, and so we get $2 back. So that's what you're seeing, that $8 difference. Now over on the cash flow statement, if I start with that 72, everything else after net income is the same. So it's going to be 20. It's going to be negative 5. We now have 87 here. From there, we're going to go down and pull out the same exact CapEx, same exact CFI as a result. And what we end up with here is 77 of CFO minus CFI. And the thing I want you to capture here between these two scenarios, so we have option A and option B, is that if we have no interest, these two calculations are the same. But the big difference here is that with the cash flow driven approach, we're starting with net income. Net income, if we look here, incorporates the impact of interest, whereas EBIT does not. And so by definition, the net income driven approach of the cash flow statement is levered. And the difference between the two, if you're drawing the comparison, is if I start with unlevered free cash flow, I work through the regular calculation. But in order to bridge from my unlevered free cash flow calculation to the cash flow driven approach, I would have to incorporate the impact of the interest expense on an after-tax basis. So that's really the connector here, is that interest on an after-tax basis, with the one caveat here, because of course there's a caveat, that this is really under US GAAP accounting. If instead you were looking at IFRS accounting, you'd have a different answer here, because the interest expense has moved down to cash flow from financing. So maybe we'll leave that for another video. And now stepping back here, the big difference between these two calculations is unlevered free cash flow captures the root cash flow of the business. So EBIT minus tax plus D&A plus or minus changes in net working capital minus CapEx. And if you wanted to bridge from that to your CFO minus CFI, you have to incorporate the impact of interest expense on an after-tax basis. And then lastly, the other question that's often asked around this is CFO a levered metric or an unlevered metric? And as we can see here, the net income is the starting point for CFO. Net income includes the impact of interest expense, at least on a US GAAP accounting basis. And so by virtue of that, CFO is definitionally a levered metric.